60 kişi nəfər.
I think we're ready to start. We're delighted to host this seminar. This is the first seminar of our center in this academic year, in the semester. And we're very honored to have as our first guest of the semester, Chief Financial Officer of the AS Group of Companies here in Baku, Mr. Mark Van Beveren. In a minute or so, Mr. Mark will introduce himself in detail. But I'd like to just give a brief information about our guest, as well as about the purpose of this today's seminar. Here, most of the attendants are from the first year of their school here. They have just taken a few introductory classes, and we also have members. Mr. Mark, you have seen them during their planned tour to AZMDF and AS Technica. So the purpose of today's seminar will be just to build on the theoretical knowledge that you have been receiving at the university. And there is no one to speak on finance, the practical aspects of finance, better than Mr. Mark. He has more than 20 years of experience in this field in many countries, including countries in Europe. He has worked with companies in different fields. He started in 1988 as a controller. That's when he started his career in finance. And he worked his way up to the position of a chief financial officer. I would like to emphasize that please pay attention to the practical aspects, because not always we'll have guests like Mr. Mark who will be talking about the practical aspects. And I would like to also to be active in the question and answer session. We have made sure that you'll have plenty of time to ask your questions. So during the seminar, if you want to take notes, please feel free to do so. And you can ask, again, questions at the end. Keep your questions to the topic. Again, it's a finance seminar. Next seminars we'll have on different topics, on human resource and other fields. But make sure your questions are specific to the topic. So with that, I'd like to ask Mr. Mark to come here and start the presentation.
Good morning, everybody. First of all, I want to thank thank you for inviting me here. It's an honor. Well, I don't have to introduce myself because that was already properly done. Well, the role of finance in determining company success, of course, that's a very broad subject. You can discuss many things about that. So what I will do is I will treat the subject of decision making, the role of a financial manager in decision making. How can you make sure that the company, that the management, top management, the board, makes the right decision in order to increase the value of a company? I'd like to start with a video presentation of our group, of AZ Group, so that you have an idea of the companies we are working.
And the responsible attitude of its team members. Pasteurized milk is offered in both 1,000 milliliter and 200 milliliter bottles. Standards. We have invested in the procurement and installation of the latest machinery. Rice, sugar, and other granular products. The company has just finished installing. Shop includes representatives of the 53 embassies and consulates operating in spirits, tobacco products, perfumery, cosmetics, chocolate, and premium caviar. There's a wide range of. This modern factory, occupying 10 hectares, employs 550 highly skilled workers and specialists, recycling all of its waste into usable materials. The company's future expansion plans include the installation. One of the most advanced companies in this field is Astikintio Limited Liability Company. Astikintio opened its first aggregate plant in the Gavala region in 2008, and since then it has. in 2010.
So I think it's quite impressive actually to see that all these companies that were established only like 4 or 5 or 6 years ago, that they can produce the volumes that they are producing today. And not only that, also it's still the case that these companies are growing rapidly. We are preparing the budget for 2014. Some companies, they will double their revenue even or triple their revenue. So quite impressive. At the same time, I want to tell something about my year in Azerbaijan. I started in Azerbaijan in October of last year. Started at Aztechnica and Azkintiol. So the companies have grown rapidly from the operational side, but at the same time, what was visible is that the finance function wasn't really able to follow that. There were some items that need to be improved. So for instance, visibility on financial performance. There was too little visibility on financial performance. If you don't know where you make profit or where you lose the cash, then obviously you also don't know what kind of measures you have to put in place to increase the profitability, to increase the value of the company. Later on I will explain what we where we improved. Control over cash flow. Control over cash flow is also very important. If you don't have a visibility of your cash positions, not only today, but also in the future, let's say 1 month from now, 2 months, or even 3 months from now, then you might come to a point where you run out of cash for a short period of time. You will not be able to pay your suppliers in time, and that will jeopardize the relationship with your suppliers. Very important to have cash flow forecasting. Systems and procedures, as most companies in Azerbaijan, the systems in place are not on the level as we are used to in Europe or in the US, where we have ERP systems in place like SAP or Oracle, which makes it harder also for the finance function to monitor and control your processes. Financing also very important. There are not a lot of companies that make the amount of profit that they are able to fund their own investments going forward. So this means that in most cases you would need a bank or investor that is prepared to finance your business, to buy the land, to buy a plant, to buy equipment in order to produce the goods and make a return on that. Quality of staff, also very important. If you don't have people on board with the right competences for what they should be doing, for the tasks that they have to carry out, for the responsibilities that they have to carry, then the outcome of all the efforts in a company will not be on the level that is expected by stakeholders of the company, owners, banks. So it's very important to have the right people on board. Actually, it's good to mention maybe that we do have people on board that are graduated from Kafkas University. So we're happy to have a good relationship with Kafkas University, and we are always happy to take people on board that studied here at this university. A little bit more on visibility on financial performance. Actually, what we had to do is to make sure that we captured all the transactions in the company in a comprehensive profit and loss account. There were no reporting sets in place at that time. Of course, there were financial overviews, but it was not a comprehensive profit and loss account that would give you the right information. So what we did is we implemented the IFRS reporting package, which I also used a lot in Europe. It doesn't mean that we, at this stage, we are IFRS proof. We need to take more steps to get at that stage. But we are getting there, and one of our aims is in 2013, over 2013, we want to have audited accounts. Audited accounts are very important in order to attract investors that want to invest in your company. If your P&L is not audited, then it gives rise to all kinds of questions. Is this the real information? Can I trust this information? When it's audited, they say, okay, we can go with this information and we have a good impression of the financial status of the company. What we also implemented is performance-based management, meaning that all the managers in the company, we gave a target. We prepared a budget for 2013 in the fourth quarter of last year. It was the first budget in the companies. So all managers knew what they had to achieve. And if all managers are thriving for those goals, then you are more sure that you will meet the targets that you have set yourself to make the company more profitable, to increase the value of the company. So it's always very important to have a budget in place. Also, it's of course you need to have a budget in place, but even more important, of course, is to measure on a monthly, on a weekly basis even, to measure where you are in terms of performance, of results. So what we did as well is we implemented a planning and control cycle. You start with the budget, then on a monthly basis you measure where you are. You create your profit and loss account and your balance sheet, and you offset that against the budget. Then in monthly management team meetings, you discuss deviations. You can be behind budget, you can be outperforming budget. But especially when you are behind budget, you need to discuss what are the reasons for that. And this is also where the finance manager plays an important role. You have to know that, you have to be on top of that. And then in the team, you need to discuss what measures you have to take, or what alternative actions or ideas you have to put in place in order to meet the budget. Operations, because some point of time the company run out of cash for a couple of days, but that's already an issue where you cannot pay your suppliers for, let's financing. I already explained that the companies are not at this stage not that far that they can finance their own business from. Hopefully we will get there coming years. Then one of the things that is in we had some initiative or some initial offers. Compare that to Europe or the US, you will have interest percentages of about 5-6% of our suppliers. As we were reporting in the IFRS reporting package, we this is in time, and that the money would come back. Also, I've been I've had a meeting in Sweden. Is the purpose of that agency is to increase export to other countries, CIS countries. This is the first time that we do business together, so we need to build a relationship, we need to build trust. So then we are talking about considerable amounts to order the components, then we have to assemble the truck. After we assemble the truck, we need time to sell it to the market and to collect the cash from our customers. So during that time, you need cash, you need funding. If you cannot get the funding, then another possibility is to have a bank prepared to cover the risk that you have during that period. So I went to Dubai, I spoke with a couple of banks, and they are prepared to cover the risk for us, and we pay a premium for that, of course. But in that way, without having the cash, without having a loan from the bank, which is very expensive in Azerbaijan, you are able to finance your business. Financing is very important. Already mentioned, I guess, most of it. Implementation of IFRS reporting set, planning and control cycle, cash flow management. On the part of cash flow management, we even have in place now a certain week's cash flow forecast, meaning that every week we refresh the forecast. We add 1 week at the end, so it's like a rolling forecast. So we know 13 weeks ahead, we know exactly how much cash we will have in 5 weeks, in 6 weeks, in 7 weeks. Then one of the things that when I came in is what I had to do is to restructure the finance department in a few cases that was not the case. In the meantime, we have now finance departments for Astechnica, for Astekintio, of which I think that we have the right people on board to make the next steps. We have found the right mix between expats, which a lot of knowledge, they have 10, 20 years experience in finance in Europe and in the US, and we were able to find enthusiastic and knowledgeable people here in Azerbaijan that came on board. We need that. One of the things that we plan for next year is an ERP implementation, and no need to tell, when you start such an implementation, then you really need to have the right people on board. In general, responsibility of a financial staff. You could say it's maximizing the company's value on a higher aggregate level. Forecasting and planning is very important, but I already explained that. I want to go further in detail on investment and financing decision, the role of the finance manager, to make sure that the right decisions will be made. Coordination and control obviously is very important. You need to report in financial terms on where you are as a company. Transactions in the financial markets, you need to be able to attract funds that you need to keep the company going. Then reporting to governmental institutions, that's something that you simply need to do. You cannot do without it. That's, for me, that's the least interesting part, I have to say, of finance. But we need to report on our results, and we need to pay taxes. That's in every country, that's the same. One of the examples is, for instance, that we are buying components from Japan. We have to pay in Japanese yen. Then there can be fluctuations. So one of the things that you can do on the financial markets is to cover that risk. Well, you can read for yourself. I think it's a little bit black and white, I have to say, but still there is a lot of truth in this as well. In most companies at this stage in Azerbaijan, finance department is simply seen as, well, they pay the bills, they collect the cash, and that's it. And obviously that's a very narrow way of looking at the finance department and what the finance department can add to the company. Then, if you want to add value to the company, then first of all you need to know what are the characteristics of a successful company. Why is a company successful? And you can read it for yourself. So all successful companies, they identify, create, and deliver products that are highly valued by customers. And not only that, also these companies are able to sell those services or products at a price that's high enough to generate enough margin to compensate enough, generate enough cash to compensate owners and to create added value. Investors, banks, owners, they should like to be compensated for the fact that they provide you funding, and also they should like to be compensated for the fact that because they give you the funding, the cash, they are exposed to risk as well. If you don't have the right people on board, if they're not motivated, if they don't have the right skills, for what you need to produce, what you need to deliver, then you'll have a problem. Also very important is to with all the stakeholders that are around the company, suppliers, investors, customers, that you have a good relationship with them, you maintain a good relationship with them. And always the challenge is to develop win-win relationships as well. And that, to name an example, I'm discussing with Volvo Finance to grant us a credit facility. Actually, we already have that. It's not covered at this moment by EKN, but that will happen next month. So then Volvo Finance is prepared to finance our business. At the same time, by doing that, we can have more units, more trucks, more construction equipment on stock. It's very important in Azerbaijan, with very short lead times, that you have enough units on stock so that you can deliver in 1 week or 2 weeks. That's very important in this country. And then already mentioned, funding is very important. Without funding, you don't have a business. So then, the role of finance. We talked about the second goal to meet in order to be successful. Then, as a finance manager, what you need to be able to do is to evaluate any proposal. Any new project could also be acquisition of a new company, for instance. You have to evaluate that project, and you need to make sure that you only pick those projects, you only work on those projects, you only buy those companies that in the end add value to your company. And that's easier said than done, of course. In general, you have 7 or 8 steps to evaluate a project from the financial perspective. First of all, you have, of course, you have the sales plan, the market study. If you want to, like for instance, Florella line, you need to be sure that the project that you produce, that you will be able to sell it to the market. You have to make an analysis of your competitors. Are we able to sell at a price that is competitive enough so that we can sell the volumes to be profitable? Calculation of cost price. I have to produce a project. I have equipment. I have people. But how much will one single project cost me? And based on that, you can come up with a markup that you need to cover also your fixed cost. Then look at the sales price again and make sure that you will be able to sell. Then together with a sales director or a sales department, you have to project sales volumes for the next coming 5 or 10 years. And when you have that information, you will be able to also project income statements, profit and loss statements for the next years. If you know the profit that you are making, then with some adjustments you are also able to project cash flows for the next 5 or 10 years. Later on I will explain why that is important as well. Then for each investment you incur some amount of risk. So management decisions are always made under some amount of uncertainty because we cannot look into the future. So one of the things as a finance manager is that you have to make very clear what is the level of risk involved in such an investment. So you can work with a best case scenario and a worst case scenario. And you may have to make very sure that you come up with the assumptions that you use to build a business case. I will show an example from practice later on. Then there are many ways to value a company or a project. There are many techniques to do that. I will go through 4 of them briefly. And they all have different outcomes, by the way. And it doesn't matter as long as you know the method that you use. What does it mean? Where do I base my decision on? Most commonly used is net present value. net present value, meaning that you take a look at the future cash flows for the next 5 years or 10 years, and then basically what you do, you calculate the net present value, meaning that you take into account that the money that you have now, 10,000, is has a higher value than cash 10,000 that you have 5 years from now. So that's the time value of money. I don't know if that's discussed already in the lessons, but so this is the technical formula. But basically, you look at okay, what will be the free cash flow? What will be the cash coming in over 5 or over 10 years? And you add that up. You have to take into account, well, free cash flow is basically that's the revenue minus your cost of goods sold, minus your fixed cost, that will give you a profit after tax. But then also you have to take into account that you need to invest into the future as well. So you have to deduct CAPEX, capital expenditure, as well over those years. Discounted value, what you use is what they call weighted average cost of capital. This is the average remuneration or interest that stakeholders or investors in a company should like to see to have as a return. So why is it a weighted average? Because your company is financed by maybe creditor, supplier credit, maybe bonds, shares, or a simple bank loan, and then those stakeholders, they expect different returns on their investment. One of the metrics is payback period. So how long does it take me if I invest, let's say, 10 million? How many years does it take to earn that back? After that, after you earn it back, let's say in 3 years you have it back, then you will start to generate cash above your investment. And that's of course the whole idea of doing business. Then in formula, yeah, I won't spend too much time on this. Just after the seminar you can read it, and if you have questions you can ask me, but this is just the mathematical side of it. But here in this example, for instance, you see that you invest 100, then it will take you 2.5 years approximately to earn it back, and after that you have excess cash. You can use this method if you have two projects to invest in, and the amount of available cash is limited. Then you may decide as management to go with project S, because there's less risk involved. You have your money earned back in 1.6 years. But it depends on the attitude of an owner, of an investor. How much risk do they want to incur? There are pros and cons to this method. It's very simple to calculate. Everybody can understand this. But then again, it does not take into account the return that you have on a project. After you earn back your cash, you stop. But in principle, the years after, you can be much more profitable than if you compare to another project. But if you don't calculate the rate of return, then you simply don't see that. Then let's skip this. One other method is the net present value. I already discussed that briefly, and you could say that if a project has a net present value which is higher than zero, that it's acceptable to invest in that project or to buy a company. Also, if you have several projects, then you can go. You can choose the project with the highest net present value. Internal rate of return. Actually, this is one that I personally prefer to use. Basically, this the internal rate of return is you can use, let's say you calculate internal rate of return on an investment and you come out on 15%, then you can compare that to other projects or other companies that you can buy, and you can make a decision for the project with the highest IRR. Also, what you need to do is to compare the IRR with the WACC that we previously discussed. So, if the rate of return is higher than what the investors in your company expect, then obviously this is well. If it's lower, then you could say we might not go with this project. Because we will not be able to give a return to the investors that they should like to see. Then again, different formula. We'll skip it for now. And you've seen all kinds of different methods. If you talk to investors or in this case the owner of the group, he made a statement several weeks ago in a meeting, and I said, well, yeah, actually, this is true. This is what it's all about. And you have all kinds of different mathematical formulas to calculate payback period or rate of return. But in principle, he says, well, I don't want to see all these formulas. Just tell me how much money do I have to invest? When will it come back? It needs to be more. And tell me when. And that's all there is in principle. But on the other hand, obviously you need to know the theory, you need to master the theory to come up with the right business case on the basis of which the right decisions can be made. This is one example from practice business case that I prepared for Isuzu assembly. We needed to make a choice. Do we really want to start assembling trucks in Azerbaijan? It's the first time. This will be the first company that does that in Azerbaijan. So I was asked to prepare a business case. First of all, as already said, you need to come up with the right assumptions. At this moment, we are in the process of building a plant next to the Aztechnica premises. This company, as Universal Motors, will start assembly of Isuzu trucks in a few months from now. Also what you have to make clear to everybody is what kind of metrics do you use to calculate profitability of the project. Here, all figures, by the way, are imaginative because it's highly confidential. We don't want our competitors to see how much profit we make. Then, first of all, as explained, you have to have an idea of your price breakdown. How much margin do you make on each truck that you sell? This margin you will need to cover your fixed expenses, your general expenses. And then, of course, you would like to have a profit on that as well. And then you can come up with a retail price. The retail price you can compare with the prices that competitors offer in the market, like Hyundai, for instance, Mitsubishi. And then you have an idea on how competitive you are. Sales forecast, this is in units, by the way. We have four types of Isuzu trucks that we want to sell to the Azerbaijan market. And these are this is the forecast that our sales director put in place. Problem with sales forecasts put in place by sales executives is always too high. So you have to remember that. So also the role of finance manager is to be critical. To challenge the sales function that they should not come up with too high expectations, because if you don't meet those expectations, then you will end up with a lower return. And then you have to explain to your investors that you didn't make the profit that you promised them. So, also very important always to keep in mind that most of the time people in sales are very optimistic, but you need to make sure that also reality is there. If you have your sales volume and you have your sales prices, then you can come up with a projection on sales. And based on the knowledge that you already have about the cost of sales, what does it cost me to produce a truck, you can build your P&L. Also, you know, you already draw on your organization chart, you know what other departments you need sales, you need also people who can manage the plant, you need purchase managers. Then you can also estimate what will be the amount of indirect labor that you have on a monthly, on a yearly basis. And then you will have your EBITDA. I don't know if EBITDA is in the meantime, does anybody know what EBITDA is?
Yeah, exactly.
So earnings before interest, taxes and depreciation. If you have your profit and loss projected, your profitability for the next coming years, then you are also able to calculate the free cash flow. So how much net cash will I have upcoming years? This is an example of how to calculate indicators, net present value, already discussed, payback period, and the internal rate of return. So in the first year, you will see a cash out under capex of 10 million. All the figures are in thousands of manat, by the way. So first year, your free cash flow will be negative. And that's mostly the case when you start new projects. Then after that, you will see that your profitability is growing, volumes are increasing, you have a higher contribution margin to cover your fixed costs, and above that to earn profit. And you see that your cash generation is increasing. Then again, you can use the discounted cash flow method, where you say, okay, then what is the value over 10 years? Of this project, and then you can come up with net present value, in this case 9.4 million. Payback period is 6 years. I think in Europe and in the US this will be considered as a very long period, and the top management might not want to go with this. At the moment, in this environment, what you see, the economy is growing rapidly and will continue to grow for the next 5-10 years. And what you see is that most companies choose a strategy of top line growth. So they huge amounts of cash are invested, knowing that in the next coming 5 to 10 years they will earn that back. And in this case, imaginative again, internal rate of return of 17.5%. What does that mean? It could be the case that there are other projects or other initiatives that you could undertake that could have a higher rate of return, and then you might choose another project. Or what you can do as well, you can say it's 10 million, I can put it in a bank account as well, and if it gives me more than 17.5%, why would I invest in a business where I incur risk? Is it clear, or are there any questions on this? No questions? So I think it's very clear then. Okay. So keep it to the end. Okay. Yeah. So then I have another example. acquisition of a company, and basically it's not so much different as deciding to making a decision to set up a plant or not, if you look at the financial aspects of it. I've been working in the Netherlands for 20 years before I came to Azerbaijan. One of the things, one of the projects that I had to look into was whether or not to buy a company in Belgium. Belgium is the country next to the Netherlands. The top management already decided that they should like to buy this company for a number of reasons. At that time we had an expansion strategy. It was before the economic crisis in Europe. And we wanted to have a footprint in the Belgian market to also sell our products there. The UCAT & V was the name of the company. They produced products, provided services that we didn't have in our portfolio. So rather than spending a lot of time and effort in developing a new business, you can also choose to buy a company, take over the management, and then you can also offer those new products in the Netherlands, in your own country. Then the question is, how do you define the price of a company? You can take over a company by asset transaction or a share transaction. In this case, we chose to have a share transfer. The business UCAT & V was owned by an individual. He set up the business for several years. He did a very good job at that. But at some point in time, he thought it would be wise now to cash and to go into other activities. Then, in this case, what we did is we determined the normalized EBITDAs over the past years to have an idea of the profitability of the company. The higher the profitability of a company in the past, but mainly in the future, of course, the higher will be normally also the sales price of a company. It's not only about profitability. Companies do need to borrow money from a bank. They do have shareholders that they have to pay out dividends. So it's also very important, if you want to buy a company, to know what are their obligations, what are their liabilities, in order to prevent buying a company. And then 1 month later, the previous owner said, hey, well, I need my dividend, and it's not in the figures. So then you might end up paying too much for a company. Calculation of entity value. Again, we saw all the difficult mathematical ways of calculating the value of a project or a company. Most of the time, top management already decided that they want to buy a company, and they go with they go with what is in the market at that time accepted. So what you see a lot is that they just have a look at the EBITDA and they say, okay, I will pay you 5x EBITDA, and that I will deduct the net debt of the company, and that's what I'm prepared to pay for your company. And of course then the negotiations start, because the owner wants to have more, because it's his company and he always thinks that is that there's more value in the company, and the buyer of course wants to reduce that price. Basically it's not much different than buying a car. When you want to buy a car, you always try to reduce the price, and the seller wants to have more for the car. So basically it's the same. But the techniques behind are much more complex, of course. What you have to do as a finance manager, you have to look at the financial figures, you have to scrutinize the financial figures to make sure that the EBITDA on which the price is based, that is the correct EBITDA. So one of the techniques we use to do that is to normalize EBITDA. In a year you can have an EBITDA of, let's say, 1 million, but there could have been events during that year that extraordinary, that is not contributing to the operational result that you normally would expect from a company. For instance, if the company had a claim from a supplier or from a customer, then you know that you will not have that same claim every year. So then you will, in that case, you will increase EBITDA. What would have been the EBITDA without this claim? And then that you can use to project into the future. And also here, you enter already the territory of negotiations, because the seller of a company also has specialists, auditors, people that assist him to sell his company, and they will try to do everything to increase the EBITDA using financial techniques. At that time, I was on the other side, so you try to do everything to reduce EBITDA and reduce the price, the purchase price. And this is actually where finance, bookkeeping becomes interesting, where you can play with the figures. But for that, obviously, you need to know very well IFRS. You need to know the accounting principles and accounting rules, otherwise you will not be able to play with it. Net debt normalization, and I think this is about the last slide. Net debt normalization, same story. You have, for instance, the company has loans that they have to repay to the bank. But then at the same time, you have to look into all the obligations that the company has. For instance, if you go through the figures of the past 5 years of a company and you see that the company has not been investing for numerous years in the past, then you can be pretty sure that once you bought the company, that you come to the conclusion that you have to spend another 2-3 million to invest, because the equipment can be you can be in a situation that you need to replace equipment. So now we are at the questions section.
You'll hang this clock, and every time you look at it, you'll remember these bright students at our university. Again, thank you so much. Thank you, guys.